The Washington Monument Syndrome is so named for a situation years ago in which the Department of the Interior was threatened with budget cuts. Now think about what a private firm does when it has to cut back. It thinks, what is the least necessary thing we do that we can therefore afford to cut back on? The state is just the opposite. It thinks, what is the most necessary thing, or the thing that the public perceives to be the most necessary that we do, and we'll cut that first, so that the public will do our work for us. The public will say, hey, wait a minute. Look, they're cutting this thing that I love so much. You better restore that whole budget. Before you know it, the budget is restored. So the Park Service said that they were going to close down the Washington Monument. They couldn't find a single pencil sharpener to sell off. They had to close the Washington Monument. And so tourists were all up in arms. Hey, whoa, we wanted access to the Washington Monument. What's going on here? That's their first thought, is what will cause the most visible pain to the public we cut there. And then people were up in arms, and before you know it, the budget was restored. Now, there's perhaps an even more illustrative example of this. During the Cold War, the U.S. government had a defensive position against any Russian attack through Germany. There was a front line covered by a cavalry regiment with light, fast-moving vehicles and good radio interception equipment. And that line was there to give the first warning of any attack. Now, at the same time as this, the U.S. government's military also had military marching bands. And to this day, the U.S. government spends $500 million a year on military marching bands. All right, so the Department of Defense is threatened with budget cuts. Now, on the one hand, they've got this line of defense to keep an eye on whether the Russians are going to attack Europe through Germany. On the other hand, they have military marching bands. Now, which of these do they first think to cut back? The marching bands, they are the safest. I mean, if you want to be in a military marching band, there's no chance you'll ever be fired. Precisely because you are the least necessary thing, they'll keep you forever. The first thing they said was, well, I guess we're going to have to get rid of this. If the Russians sweep into Western Europe, we won't even know it's happening because of you people who want to cut back on the budget. An odd priority. Now, it's not that I'm a big fan of the U.S. military or whatever, but if you had a private firm keeping an eye on the Russians, probably they'd cut back on the marching bands first. That's the Washington Monument Syndrome. Now, related to this is one of my favorite empirical examples. Back in the 1980s, there was an economist with the Brookings Institution, slightly left of center think tank. And out of curiosity, he wanted to know how many bureaucrats worked in the central office of the New York City public school system. So he gets on the phone. The first half dozen people he talks to have no idea what that number is. The second half dozen people he talks to do know what the number is, but they're not authorized to reveal it. The 13th person both knows the number and can reveal it, and the answer was 6,000 bureaucrats in the central office. So he thought, all right, well, I don't know what to compare that to. Let's see if we can compare it to something. Let's call the Archdiocese of New York. Now, they educate 1/6 as many students, so they should have 1,000 bureaucrats. Calls them up. First person answers. He says, how many bureaucrats work in your central office? And the woman says, I don't know. And he thinks, here we go again. But she says, wait a minute, let me count. The answer was 26. Now, what does this have to do with the Washington Monument Syndrome? Whenever there'd be some budget cut in New York City, first thing they would go after would be police and fire. Right? Your house is burning down and somebody's trying to murder you. Well, we're not going to, you know, normally we'd be there in an hour and a half to help you out. But now this time, ain't no way that's happening. Let me note, by the way, I'm sure the judge can attest to this, but just one small aside. When I was doing my graduate work, I was once visited by an old friend, and we had dinner somewhere around 112th and Broadway. And when we came out, his car had been broken into. Now, this sort of thing has happened to me very, very infrequently. His car had been broken into, and his stereo system had been removed, and some music had been taken. And it so happened a policeman was driving by. So we thought, what the heck, you know, we've been robbed. Let's see what we're getting for our money. So we flagged him down. We said we were just robbed. All this stuff has been taken. And the policeman, this is absolutely what happened. He told us what an awful shame that was, and he drove away. And that was it. Now, again, imagine if a private firm did that. Hey, look, you know, you're living in New York City. What do you expect? We would be up in arms about this. There'd be investigative reports about it, corruption. But we just sort of figure, well, you know, that's just the way the state is, you know. Can't expect them to do everything. We let them off the hook in ways we never let the private sector off the hook, right? You go clothes shopping, there's one little thread out of place, and you let that salesman know all about it. But meanwhile, somebody just stole your stuff, and you're going, well, you know, hey, nobody's perfect. You know, or the TSA is actually, there's a hand going into your pants, and you're going, that's just keeping me safe. Now, look, I'm all in favor of holding the private sector to high standards, because I know the private sector can meet those standards, but it is worth noting that we have this double standard. But my point is, at what point in New York do they say, we better go after the 6,000 people in that central educational office doing heaven knows what? Doesn't even occur, those are sinecures. Those people will be there forever. Doesn't even occur to them, not even remotely on the radar screen. By the way, one more New York anecdote. John Kenneth Galbraith, a very prominent left-wing economist for many, many years, famously said there was nothing wrong with New York that a doubling of the city budget couldn't solve. Then they tripled the city budget and everything got worse. And so, of course, Galbraith came forward and apologized to everyone for... No, he didn't. You know that doesn't happen. I can't believe you fell for that. Apologize. These people don't apologize. Or what about something like the war on drugs? Now, I talked at the Mises Circle in Houston this year. We have this event every year in Houston in January about the war on drugs. We were talking about the police state. And I pointed out that the war on drugs, like all government programs, is not just a matter of winning an intellectual argument. You can't say to yourself, look, I was the captain of my high school debate team, so you just wait till the country hears my argument against the drug war. It's going to be over the next day. It's more than that, because there are people whose livelihoods are at stake here. It's not just a matter of dispassionately weighing the pros and cons and saying, oh, you know what? On second thought, maybe prison rape isn't the best solution to drug abuse after all. It isn't that. It's that people begin to subconsciously associate the common good with their own personal good. And their own personal good is, I get a salary from prosecuting the drug war. So the bureaucracies to which the drug war gives rise become self-perpetuating. And they're just going to go on forever. So when the budget cuts come along, they'll make sure that police and fire get cut, but these things continue. So it's not just the DEA and the military, but it's also the State Department, the Department of Agriculture, the Bureau of Indian Affairs, the land management. They all get money from the drug war. The money is everywhere. Tens of thousands of people work full-time on the drug war. That's what you're up against. You're up against that type of vested interest every single time you try to overturn something. Now, remember what this number two point was, that government is a public service agency with no interests of its own that are separate from the general interest. But here, as we've seen, the state is a group of fiefdoms, self-perpetuating fiefdoms, who want to expand their power and their budgets. And that is an interest that is at odds with the interests of the general public. Or what about the military? Now here, I mean, surely this is where the government does its best job. It keeps us safe. There's no other way we could be kept safe, so we have to take the good with the bad here. Well, when we look closely at the functioning of the military-industrial complex, it turns out that it's really a lot of abuses. How about that? I have a chapter on this in my hideously titled book, Rollback. I have a chapter on the military-industrial complex. I'm very happy with it. It actually began as a paper at the Austrian Scholars Conference of the Mises Institute, which is now the Austrian Economics Research Conference, held every March. Well, just one of the points that I noted in there is that you notice that the military-industrial complex has kind of a reputation for being wasteful or for developing some weapon system long after everyone has concluded that either it doesn't work or the enemy they were designing it for went kaput 20 years ago. It just carries on. It carries on. No private firm could get away with that, producing a product that no one would voluntarily buy. and yet it just goes on and on. How does this happen? You know, I mean, you might be against it, but you've got to be curious. How do they carry on this racket? And it turns out they have two primary methods that reinforce each other. The first one is known as front loading. This is a term that is used in Pentagon circles. So they all know what it is. Front loading means that when the firm makes the initial description and promise of the particular system, it does so in a way that overstates what this system will be able to deliver. Oh, this thing's going to be great. It's stealthy. You can't see it. Won't show up on radar. And don't worry, it costs like 15 bucks. Well, all right, we'll take 100 of those, good sir. Okay, you think, all right, Woods, I don't see how that's going to last forever. Eventually they're going to realize, well, it's not stealthy at all. I mean, it's all over the radar screen. It has a big Hello Kitty sticker on the side. You know, like, at some point, that's not going to work for them. Or they're going to realize it costs $1 million or $1 billion or whatever. But that's when the second plank of the strategy comes in. This is how, once they get the taxpayer spigot opened, they keep it open, and it never closes. The second one is called political engineering. This is when you make sure that you divide the jobs and the profits across as many congressional districts as possible. So many congressmen now have a vested interest in keeping that project going. You especially want to target congressional districts where the congressman is a committee chairman, where he's really influential. Then this thing will never be stopped. Never. It just goes on and on. And you think, now here, this is the most fundamental task associated with government. People who are minarchists will say, I agree with the libertarian, their anarcho-capitalist message all the way up to a point, but I know for security we need the state. So here is its most fundamental task, and even here it has interests of its own. Even here it is not just dispassionately looking out for what's best for the rest of us. And then meanwhile, of course, the Pentagon in the U.S. is not subject to audit. So it's not that they fail the audit, it's that there is no audit, and you wind up with all kinds of cases where there's $1 trillion missing. Since 9/11 to 2010, there's $1 trillion missing. Their budget increased by $2 trillion, and $1 trillion of it they cannot account for. The other trillion went for the wars, but there's $1 trillion, and it's not like, well, the Navy bought a lot of ships. It didn't. The Navy actually declined during those years, etc. You look through the armed forces, that doesn't seem to account for where the money went. Oh, well, you know, can't win them all. Can't please everybody. It's a standard that we would never think of holding the private sector to such a pathetically low standard. But when it comes to this, when it comes to the state, we've just been taught these are wise public servants doing their best. And that leads to this naive result.